Happy Tuesday and welcome back to Centonomy Career Lounge. My name is Tessie Omulo and again, this is another week. Our word of the week this week is optimism. I need you to think about that one friend who's always optimistic about things in their life. And now based on the topic we're going to discuss today, there's something about just being optimistic or just thinking about the best outcome in everything that you do. So how optimistic are you about your life situation? I have amazing guests with me today. And why I thought about this conversation is millennials usually want to hear from other millennials. So we usually go for job interviews almost every 3-5 years, or for most people, very often. And we need to know what we need to do and what we don't do during interviews. So I'd like my guests to introduce themselves. I have Oscar and I have Nelly with me. So they'll both introduce themselves and we can talk about these things. Karibuni.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Tell us, who are you? What do you do?
Hello, my name is Ian Oscar Kipng'eno. I am a customer success specialist at Fuzu. Ideally, my biggest focus at Fuzu is our employers. And what I do is ensure that they're able to get the best from the platform and also be in a position to identify the top talent from the application that candidates make on Fuzu.
Okay, great.
Okay. Hey, thank
you. Tell us about yourself.
Thank you very much for having us. So my name is Nelly Mutula. I'm in charge of HR and talent acquisition at Fuzu. What does that mean? So talent acquisition is essentially where we work with our employer partners to help them, as Oscar said, find the right talent. So I'm part of the process where we help with interviewing and pre-screening and selecting the best candidate for employers, but also making sure that Fuzu is the best place to work with the people that we have in the team as well. So that's what I do.
Amazing. Yes. That means on a day-to-day basis, you meet a lot of people who are actually job seekers.
Tell me about it. Yes.
Exactly. So I think you're the right person to have this conversation with.
Mm-hmm.
Usually there's the three phases when you're having a job, when you get a job opportunity,
sure.
Right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So when you're invited for an interview, there's mm-hmm. something you need to do before, mm-hmm. there's the interview process itself, mm-hmm. and there's after.
Yes.
So we're going to talk about what you need to do mm-hmm. For these three phases.
Okay.
So tell me. What do you guys think, from your own opinion or mm-hmm. from your own experiences, mm-hmm. what do you need to do before any interview?
Okay. I know you've said that all of us are millennials and we are technically talking to millennials like us.
Yes.
And I know most people never have an opportunity to talk to someone and help them, to talk to someone who can help them understand what do I need to do during an interview, before, after, and all these aspects.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll probably, when we start off with before.
Mm-hmm.
So before is you've gotten this call, so you've been applying for jobs and then you're the lucky few who get to be called for an interview, right? So what do you need to do? There are two aspects of it. So there's the personal aspect, what you need to do yourself. Then there's also now an aspect that is related to the job.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll talk about what you need to do when it comes to the job.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a company that you applied for. They've liked your CV. That means then you're already 1 foot into the door, right? So what you need to do is, one, you need to do a review of the company itself. So get to understand what is this company's mission, what is vision, what are they trying to do, what are they trying to contribute to the society. The other aspect that you need to learn is about the team itself. One thing that employers usually look for is your culture fitness. And you cannot be able to define or even show whether you're a culture fit to that organization if you don't know what their culture is. So look at their values. What do they live by? Are those things that also for you live by? Because if you look at the culture values and you find probably they have something that maybe conflicts with your own personal values,
mm-hmm.
maybe that's not the company that you need to be working for. But then when you find that everything ticks, or this is the company I'm invited to learn about, then now you look at the team that is already there. I mean, there's so many sources that you can find about the team itself. So you can use the company website, you can use Google, just to Google who is the founder, why did they create the company itself, where is the company going, what is their short-term goal, what is their future and all that. And then after that, you also need to do a bit of research about the role itself. So I know you will have access to the job description that you use to apply for this job. So get to understand what are the responsibilities. If I'm coming to be a manager, if I'm coming to be maybe a graduate trainee, what are going to be my responsibilities? What are things that you need to demonstrate during the interview? Then also the job description also covers what the employer is looking for in terms of personality, in terms of soft skills and hard skills. These are things that you need to prepare yourself on how you'll be able to evaluate for that. Then the other aspect of it is also now the person is coming to interview you. If it's Nelly who has called you for an interview, get to know, what does Nelly do?
What if I don't know Nelly? I mean, it was a phone call. Mm-hmm. Then it could be anyone. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, if I call you, if I'm a good employer and I call you, I'll let you know, hey, my name is Nelly, I work for Fuzu.
Okay.
So then from that, you go Google, who is Nelly at Fuzu? Then get to know, what does Nelly do? Maybe, I wouldn't recommend this, but stalk them. Really, just go to their, yes, go to their whatever profiles. Yeah. Maybe it's their social profiles, and just get to know, what do they like doing? Over the weekends, and then maybe you can use this as a nice breaker. But then also the other thing that you need to do as well is, once you've already done the research about the company itself, mm-hmm. now there's the next aspect about you as a person, mm-hmm. right?
First, let me jump in, Oscar. Yeah. Sorry. There's something you say that was really interesting. Mm-hmm. When it comes to research, there's mm-hmm. not only the fact that you research about the company mm-hmm. only mm-hmm. To know what they do. Mm-hmm. It's also to understand if you fit in there.
Definitely.
I mean, you can be the best for the company, but is it the best for you?
100%.
So that's an interesting aspect to it.
Yes.
To it. Thank you, Nelly.
Because yeah. then also, when it comes to the aspect of whether the company is a fit for you, mm-hmm. it also determines so that you'll stay with them for long.
Exactly.
So if you come in and 3 months down the line, you're looking for a job, clearly you made the wrong decision when you were coming in. So that's why you need to do that research.
Great.
Yeah.
Thank you. Oscar,
yeah.
It's your turn.
Yes. The second phase of it, which is the personal side, and mm-hmm. how do you prepare for interview from the personal standpoint is, you need to actually groom well. I mean, mm-hmm. like you need to look the part. Yeah. Doesn't mean that you have to put on a tie during the interview.
Okay.
But you should look sharp, really sharp.
Mm-hmm.
I think when you walk into to the interview room, your first impression normally carries a lot of weight in terms of the impression that you make to the client mm-hmm. or the employer they're employing with,
okay.
you're looking to get employed with.
Okay.
That bit is actually stay away from trying to figure out a lot of things that you might not need during the interview,
mm-hmm.
but doing a bit more of research that might not help you.
Mm-hmm.
So the ideal is stick to the job description as you mentioned,
mm-hmm.
but still tap into what actually are your strengths so that you can bring them out during that
true.
Interview.
True.
Okay.
Yeah. So that ideally those two key areas are what would stand out, actually the grooming, and maybe something that most millennials miss out on, they know they're Ubers to catch, but then again you'll find someone be like, hey, I'll be there in the next 15, just nearby,
wow,
right?
Okay.
And then knowing
you underestimate.
That, yes, and yeah. Considering that we have traffic and all these things, so it's really good to get at the venue, at the interview venue earlier on. It can be an hour before, sit there at a restaurant nearby, have coffee. It helps you ease in your nerves before even the interview itself.
Great.
Yes. Yeah.
So groom well, look nice. I mean, that's the least you can do,
yes.
you know?
Yeah.
And two, you said stick to the, you know, to the what you've been called to be.
Yes. Yes.
Don't go out of what you need to do. Just read what you need to prepare for and prepare well.
Yeah.
Great.
Yeah.
So let's move into during.
Mm-hmm.
So you come into the interview.
Mm-hmm.
What do you need to do? Just give me one each.
Okay.
What do you need to do? I hear the people say, please don't pour that cup of tea for yourself.
Mm-hmm.
I've never known why.
Mm-hmm.
Only it's, you end up, you know, dropping everything. I don't know.
Yeah.
So what do you need to do? You're walking into the interview or even at the reception. I hear some interviews start at the reception area.
Mm-hmm.
What do you need to do when you're at the interview venue or the location? Yeah.
Okay. I mean, it's very true when people say the interview starts the minute you walk into the gate.
Mm-hmm.
It's not even at the reception, it's at the gate.
At the
gate. Way you treat that the person who is manning the gate, to the way you treat the person who opens the door for you when you get into the reception, to the way you treat the person who is going to be interviewing you, matters. Because when I'm deciding the new, the right fit for us, I'll go ask the reception, how did this person treat you? Or you'd look at the cameras and see how you walked in. Did you treat them in a way that was kind enough? Because remember, an environment is a teamwork environment. So if you can't deal with everyone, then you're not the right fit for that specific job. But then what do you need to do when you're coming into the interview? The key thing I tell people is confidence. Carry your confidence. Before you come for this interview, talk to yourself. Tell yourself, I got here because I have qualified for this job. I am here to prove that I'm qualified for this job. They will ask me questions, I will answer them because I know I'm qualified for this job. Always, like, positive reaffirmation of yourself.
Yeah.
That's the only, yes, optimism, I mean.
Yeah.
So that's the thing that you need to be able to show. Because the minute you walk in, fine, you're well-groomed, but then you walk in and you can't even speak. You can't even express yourself. Then already, I'm already disqualifying you. Maybe if you're coming in for a customer service job, this is a job that would require you to be able to show your communication skills,
yeah.
and maybe that's a time where you're nervous, you're feeling a sieve, or I'm doubting myself, so your confidence goes out the window. So here, you need to be able to carry your confidence for you to be able to prove that you're actually the right fit for this job.
Exactly.
Yes.
confidence,
yes.
Optimism.
Yes.
You know you're the one.
Mm-hmm.
They chose you.
Yes.
Next, Oscar, tell us. What else? Congratulations.
Yeah. So once you've been invited to sit down and the panel has introduced itself,
yeah.
And then you are to introduce yourself, just take it easy, introduce yourself, but be very keen and be an active listener.
Yes.
Pay attention to the names of who was actually interviewing you.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe when you're doing your research, you knew about Nelly,
mm-hmm.
but then now there's Oscar and there's another operations person during the interview. So it's really keen for you to actually know them.
Mm-hmm.
And even when you ask questions, be very keen to, you can even put down the question you're being asked,
mm-hmm.
And then answer them one by one. And I think it gives you an opportunity to structure even your thoughts and give the right answer that the panelists need you to provide.
Okay. Yeah. So relax.
Yes.
Basically,
yeah.
Relax,
listen,
and listen.
Yeah.
Yes, perfect.
Yes.
Thank you. Now we want to move to after.
Mm-hmm.
You've worked out, you're like, I aced it or not.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, what did I do, Tessie?
Yeah.
I mean, what was that answer?
Mm-hmm.
What do you need to do after?
Okay.
If they don't communicate, do you communicate?
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's usually like that relationship. You know,
mm-hmm.
should I call first?
Yes.
Are they going to call me?
Call me.
What do you do after the interview?
Okay. Before I answer this, I'll go back to during the interview.
Mm-hmm.
One thing I tell people to do is always ask questions.
Mm-hmm.
This can be maybe clarifying. So let's say I asked you a question where you felt I wasn't 100% at it.
Yeah.
When you're given an opportunity for you to ask questions, even if they don't, you just tell them, do I have a chance for me to be able to just clarify a few things that I had?
Mm-hmm.
Here's the point where then now you're interviewing the company itself. So you're not doing it in a harsh way.
Okay.
You need to be very polite about it. You need to be very professional about it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not digging for information that you don't need to get at this point. But it can be as simple as, one, clarifying a question that you didn't understand, or two, just getting to understand, okay, I noticed that you guys are actually planning to move to Uganda, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
So is this role going to also be working in Uganda? So it's more like trying to get as much information about the company and the role itself, such you live there knowing everything has been catered for. And the other thing when it comes to listening is employers always give you the next steps. And this is during the interview.
Yeah.
So once you're done, they'll tell you, okay, so we're going to reach out to you in the next 2 weeks, or someone is going to be reaching out to you before the end of the day, or whichever timeline that they give you. So if you listen to them and you realize that they've said within the end of the day,
mm-hmm.
and the end of you go home, and then the end of the day is here.
Yeah.
What do you do? Do you call them? No. That means then either you need to give them time, because either they've already made that decision and called the candidate that they chose for this specific job, or they decided, okay, let's see whether we can find someone else within today, and then we'll call you tomorrow.
Okay.
So usually say give at least a 5-day or maybe 2 to 5 days period before you call back, in case you're not called back.
Okay.
Or after the interview, the thing that you need to do is also share a thank you. If I called you for an interview, I'll also share with you an email. So you already have my email address, right? So you also need to send me a thank you, telling me, I thank you for the opportunity to interview me. This is maybe emphasizing several skills that you feel were very critical for that specific job. So emphasizing why you think you're the right fit for the job. And then just ending it, hoping to hear from you soon. Regards, Nelly. And that's it. So then for me, I'll be prompted to actually now want to give you feedback simply because you reach out to me.